Good, thanks. Senator Fisher.
Thanks, Chair. thank you, Mr. Martin. In your submission, you talk about your support of the objects of the Act. Don't the objects of the Act need to be reworded to make it clear that they're about reducing the negative impact of stuff?
I actually had a laugh when you commented on that earlier. As somebody who's done a lot of work on regulatory analysis and understanding positive and negative impacts, there are specifically positive impacts that should be identified.
And they might be good, and we might want to continue that impact.
We've actually had similar discussions as part of preparing the issues paper and as part of our product stewardship principles and actions.
Well,
and that there are often a range of positive impacts on programs, and they do warrant support.
Yes. So positive impacts should not a product that has or a substance that has a positive impact shouldn't be the subject of a mandatory reduction scheme, should it?
Not necessarily. If there are a range of other criteria in which industry is stepping up, and in some cases industry will say we need a mandatory program to make this work.
Yeah.
And that's sensible if industry is stepping up to the plate. If industry is not being as proactive as they should, or voluntary and co-regulatory approaches have been tested, there's been a legitimate attempt to make them work, and for whatever reason they don't, then it makes sense to try and have more of a mandatory approach.
We can have a bit of a laugh, as you said you did have, but it's not really a joke, because the government's been working on this for a long time, and it's not really a joke that they haven't got their drafting together. You've talked about the consultation paper, and much of your submission is based on the consultation paper. When did you get that? When did you first see the bill, and how much time have you had to adjust your sites between the consultation paper and the actual bill?
I first of all, I represented the council on the stakeholder reference group, so I was active in some of the earlier discussions about the bill and discussions with the department. I also participated in the public workshops in Sydney for the bill and for the TV and computer schemes. I provided a range of input on that, but I didn't actually see the bill until after it was introduced.
So when was that?
And
end of March, mid-March?
Mid-March.
Okay.
My understanding is we were due to see a draft so that we would have a chance to comment, but timing with the legislative process meant that wasn't available.
Well, whatever the reason, you didn't see a pre-exposure draft.
We didn't see it, so we had a bit of a scramble to pull everything together and provide our subsequent submission and testimony.
Yes, and particularly given that you're highlighting discrepancies between what you thought the consultation paper said would happen versus what the bill seems to say will happen, right?
Well, I'm cautiously optimistic that there's room for amending these to help address things such as objects and criteria.
But you are nonetheless agreeing there are differences.
There are some differences,
okay,
and we're happy to help in addressing those.
Okay, thank you. Then my final area of questioning is, as you say on the bottom of page 2 of your submission, you say that, the criteria is quite broad and could apply to virtually every product sold in Australia. Now, I would hope that no government and no minister would be so foolish, but nonetheless, it is an issue if the underpinning legislation potentially allows that to happen. You, and I'm getting to my question here, you've also said that it's better if, I can use your words, if industry can embrace a product stewardship program, and you used the words giving industry control and flexibility. In your experience as the Global Stewardship Council, is it, even though you might have a bill that says this can cover everything, isn't it sensible to have a bill that empowers industry so that with, product stewardship, effectively you can have industry stewards, shop stewards if you like, we've got a Labor government, industry stewards, for example, the ag stewardship people and yourselves. Isn't that what you would be saying should be happening with this bill?
We support the fact that the bill is actually innovative in that it does give a greater underpinning towards the voluntary and co-regulatory schemes. And as I said in my statement, that really does deserve support. I would like to see the potential to address a broader range of industry concerns in the objectives and the criteria, many of the things that you've been hearing about already. And I do think that if we have a prioritization system for other items down the road, that we can have greater stakeholder buy-in, greater opportunity to input, and that would benefit not only the stakeholders, but governments and nonprofits. You know, so often a lot of the discussions have been polarized today, and I think the department deserves a lot of credit for trying to come up with something that was sensible. And as I highlighted in our submission, we think they did address a number of things quite well in the bill and did reflect a number of issues. Okay. They did show that they were listening.
Thanks, Mr. Martin. Time is short. I forgot one further question. Criteria F.
Don't want to say too much positive.
Criteria F. No, let's hope, and there needs to be more of that. I'm happy if you let me have the time, if we can tack off the...
You're chewing your own time up.
Criteria F talks about taking action to reduce the impacts that will offer business opportunities that will make a contribution to the economy. In your experience, what is the potential for a third party, if no one else, to argue that reducing the impacts of a product or a substance on the environment or health will offer that business opportunities, i.e. waste reduction or elimination, for example, could offer a third-party business the prospect to make money? That's pretty easy to argue, isn't it?
I would suggest that the best business opportunities are best identified by the businesses that see those opportunities, and if they have a means of being active in the process and putting to government the fact that they could make a stewardship program work, there is a compelling business case, then they deserve support, and I wouldn't want to see the bill harm those efforts. We've seen a range of programs come forward without the need for legislation in the voluntary and co-regulatory approaches. They've done quite well. In some cases, you have industries saying that they need some sort of regulatory underpinning to make their scheme work, as with the TV and computer scheme. I would think that the economic value that we're seeing in effective product stewardship schemes means there's a very broad range of commercial opportunities.
Well, couldn't criteria F be argued in respect of every product?
It could, but I'm having some faith in the system to help to weed out every idea. It makes sense to have prioritization for things like items that are toxic, hazardous, or expensive to manage for local waste programs, or if businesses come forward and say, we think that there is, that it makes sense to have a product stewardship scheme in place, we're prepared to undertake this, and we want to be active in how the scheme might unfold.
Does the bill set out those sensible priorities, in your words?
Not as well as I would like to see. It goes part of the way.
Where?
And having that criteria alone is a good step in the right direction. But
you said yourself it's kind of a kitchen, these are not my words, not yours, but your submission suggests they're basically kitchen sink criteria in suggesting in your submission that the bill could apply to virtually every product sold in Australia.
That's why I do think there is some room for amending the criteria and the objects to clarify.
Let's hope.
And to clarify the process. The explanatory memo actually had a pretty good assessment of the implications of these different clauses and how it would be applied.
Yeah, but the implications aren't in the bill, Mr. Martin.